Ladies and gentlemen, Kreskin.
You've been with us for a long, long time. I've done this. Gee, I did it in England. I did it the first year on this series. I think it was sitting in the audience. And I guess it's been associated with me more than anything I do with playing cards. Of course, this is not ESP. This is pure sleight of hand. But I have a surprise for you after I show it to all of you. Let me cut the cards a little bit. That's called the Hindu shuffle, which doesn't mean anything except it's a common shuffle in India. Now, there's a nine of diamonds. I'll show this to you first of all. As many of you have seen and perhaps talked about in the past, I've inserted it in the deck. Actually, it's 26 down from the top. It's all the way in, and watch. Oh, I love this effect because there you are, folks. It's back on the top of the deck. Right back on. And they're all different. All different. Well, later on, you're going to see that same effect. In a way that an awful lot of people have wanted to, you're going to see it. We've filmed it this afternoon, and we're going to show it to you in slow motion, twice, both times in slow motion. Lux, come on up here for a moment. I knew you were out there ready to throw a ping pong. Will you meet Bill Luxton again? He talked to you. How are you, Bill?
You know, I'm going to be black and blue before this series is over. Then you're pounding on the shoulders.
Yeah, Mike Douglas says I shake hands like I'm milking a cow. I don't mean it. This is the way I kind of function. I tell you, this is... I wanted to show Bill this because I'm very, very proud of it. As you can see, Bill, it is a book. It's an interesting story. It's ivory. Beautiful design there. And then the man who made this book for me, I don't think anyone watching or very few people watching would know about. His name was Dr. Jax, who was a Swiss... magician, and I only knew him for about 10 minutes. I only met him for about 10 minutes in my life. I can't tell how this came into my possession. It's only one of two of its kind, and what's interesting is it really isn't a book. Look, Lux, this area is for autographs. He would take this from table to table as he performed at salons, and look at this. Inside here, he'd use this to lay on the table to perform on. To you, and inside were all his materials.
Oh, I see.
The compartments and what have you. In fact, I'm going to take a couple of things out here which may assist me in an effect or two, and we'll leave everything else here of Dr. Jax. This is an effect he created. How about, Lux, if I have you pick someone from the audience?
I didn't see any ping pong balls in
there. No, that's the one thing. How about if I have you step out there,
okay,
Lux? We'll
fine.
Pick someone.
Right.
And while Lux is doing that, I'll just take my materials here. Can we pick anyone in the audience, Lux? If the ball lands by you, there you are. Boy, sir, that landed in your lap. Come on up here on stage real fast. Would you, my friend? I don't know you personally, do I, sir? Huh? Come on over here, in fact. Let me have you stand to my right. What's your name?
Doug Gallant.
Doug, good to see you. My pleasure. Come a little bit closer. There goes that handshake again. You got me so self-conscious. He really has me self-conscious. Doug, these cards are called the four. There are four. I thought I had five, but we're going to use them. Actually, they're black. They're almost lucite type cards. I don't know if I can show these close up here. But, Doug, let me count them here on the table. There is one, which I'll place there, two, three, if I can show you both sides of this, four. While the cards are resting there, I'm going to ask you to draw a card out of the deck. As a matter of fact, I'm going to have to qualify that card. It's Doug. Your name is Doug. Notice for a mentalist how I got this so darn clearly. Let me remove the jokers from the deck, if I may. Usually people ask me to leave the stage if that's the request. But I'm going to ask you to stop me at a red card. I'll cut cards out of the deck. That is a black one. I'll cut a card there. That was a red one. But you'll do this with the deck face down. Just call stop.
Stop.
All right, if it's a black one, tell me and we'll start all over again. Is it
no,
red or black?
It's red.
It's red. We'll set it down there. If I may, why don't you take this marking pencil, take the top off of it, please, if you will, and I'm going to ask you to autograph the back of the card. Just place your initials across it. That would be called autographing the back of the card. Now, we'll set that on the table thusly, if I may. You can put the top on. Now, if you will, Doug, what I'd like you to do is just to point out, touch any two cards, please, on the table. Those two right there. I'm going to take them. Would you hold your hand out, please? and we'll place these two cards one on top of the other. In fact, I'm not even going to handle them. Pick them up side by side and lay them on the glass. Leave them together, tight together, and just pick them up and lay them on the glass, please. Now, I don't think there's any problem. Listen, folks, I don't think there's any problem. I didn't look at a monitor, but I'm going to look at the card that he gave me, if I may. Six of hearts. All right, that's fine. Doug, if I may, let me insert this card between these two like that. And hold your hand, palm down your left hand, like that. Hold your fingers a little bit higher so the cards will not fall off. Now, I've placed that six of hearts so that it is facing one of the black cards. By the way, these are not photographic cards. They are mere cardboard, which Dr. Jacks made in the form of darkness or blackness. We know your card was the six of hearts. I had you autograph it. Look, Doug, if we may, if I can remove that black card. It's going to be fascinating. Your initials are still there. Look, the card, your six of hearts, is blank, even though it's still autographed. And look what wiped off onto the black card. The very six pips of your six of hearts. Isn't that wild? Isn't that wild, Doug? You're pretty good, thank you, I said. And folks, we're going to be back in just a very, very few seconds. Our special guest is a lecturer and truly one of the forerunners in the area of long-distance telepathy. He's written many books. One has been a bestseller, Thoughts Through Space. And it's interesting what Dr. J.B. Rhine said about Thoughts Through Space. The great pioneer in ESP said it's the most entertaining book I've ever read on the subject of telepathy and a great contribution to the study of extrasensory perception. Meet its author, Mr. Harold Sherman. Mr. Sherman, one of your major tests in long-distance telepathy involved Sir Hubert Walkins. Can you tell us about it? Now, he was an explorer that went to the Arctic. What is the test? What did it deal with?
The test concerned the Russians, and they tried to fly nonstop several planes over the North Pole.
The Russians did?
We're going clear back, Kreskin, to the year 1937. They flew two planes nonstop over the North Pole and landed them in the United States, but the third plane was forced down some 200 miles from the pole, never heard from again. But the Russians thought their flyers might still be alive in the Arctic wastes. And so they hired Sir Hubert Walkins, a famous Arctic explorer, to outfit an expedition and fly north from New York City in search of the lost Russian flyers. Sir Hubert Walkins and I were co-members of the City Club of New York at that time. And when he found that I was interested in telepathy and been privately experimenting and believed under certain conditions I could receive thoughts, he suggested to me that he didn't know how long he was going to be gone searching for the lost Russian flyers, but if I would care to conduct an experiment in long-distance telepathy, he would like to try to transmit thought impressions to me.
Did you do this kind of regularly, like every night or every couple of nights at a certain hour?
Sir Hubert set the time, Mondays, Tuesdays, and Thursdays, 11:30 to 12 midnight Eastern Standard Time, and he would synchronize the difference in time as he flew further north.
What happened with the test? How did it work out? I know, but you've got to tell our viewers.
In the event that they should be successful, Sir Hubert suggested we go to Columbia University and contact Dr. Gardner Murphy, then head of the psychology department.
Fantastic pioneer.
Dr. Gardner Murphy then suggested that each time I had recorded my impressions each night, I would make typewritten records of them, put them in the mail, addressing them to him at Columbia University, so they'd be protected by government postmark and carry their own automatic proof that long before I could get a check report from Wilkins' diary and log, Dr. Gardner Murphy was on record with my impressions as of those dates.
You had a number of dramatic results. Can you tell us one of them, Mr. Sherman?
I'd like to say specifically that after 5.5 months of continuous recording of impressions, some hundreds of them, it was found that some 70% remarkably accurate, as we checked against Wilkins' diary and log.
Was there something about a stove, an incident, or a little bit?
Well, but there was one also that has been commented upon from one country to the other for many, many years. It was this. On Armistice Night 1937, as I sat in my study in New York City and concentrated my mind upon Wilkins, I saw in my mind's eye, much as you would see a scene from a motion picture that is stored in your memory, the following scene, and described it something like this. see you taking off on flight, which seems to be toward Saskatchewan. I have a feeling you've been caught in a heavy blizzard and compelled to turn back and land at some place that seems like Regina. I see you, Wilkins, roped in an armistice ball that appears to have been held here this evening. I see many men and women in military attire and evening dress.
Evening
you,
dress.
Wilkins, appear to be in evening dress yourself. And when I had recorded these impressions and sent them in to Dr. Gardner Murphy, and he put them on record, some 2 or 3 weeks later, a check report from Wilkins' diary log was received in New York City. He recorded something like this on this night. He would transmit and relive and review in mental picture form what had happened to him, and this is what he recorded. This morning took off on flight for, hoping to reach Saskatchewan, was caught in blinding snowstorm, compelled to turn back and make a landing at Regina, was met at the airport by the governor of the province, who invited me to attend an armistice ball being held this evening. Mm-hmm. My attendance at this ball was made possible by the loan to me of an evening dress suit.
Oh, my gosh. Listen, we've got to pursue some of Harold Sherman's other research and experiences, and we'll be back in just a moment, folks. Harold, tell us about your most recent experiments with Ingo Swann of Stanford University. Am I correct?
Yes.
And it's involved right now. I mean, it's continuing, isn't it?
Ingo Swann is one of the outstanding scientists in the world today, and he's been under test at Stanford Research Institute in Menlo Park, California, for the last 5 months. The scientists there suggested that Ingo Swann and I engage in a most unusual type of test. They wanted to have us independently project our minds through time and space to contact the planet Jupiter.
I've got to interrupt there because this is so foreign to so many interviews on the program. In other words, Harold, you were not to communicate with someone telepathically at another planet, but the planet itself, Jupiter.
That is
clairvoyantly
correct.
I suppose.
That is correct.
Now, so what's happened then, Harold?
Now, on April 27th, at 8 o'clock my time in Mountain View, Arkansas, where I live, my ESP Foundation offices are in Little Rock, Arkansas, I sat in my study, and by a method of fixing my mind on the objective, which objective was Jupiter at that time, 400 million miles away, Ingo Swann, at 6 o'clock his time in California, was also sitting and concentrating in his in the way he's learned how to concentrate. We're recording independently our impressions of what Jupiter looked like and what the situation was in the Jupiter area. And then after the half hour assigned to the, for this purpose, they telephoned me and I dictated my impressions, and then they compared them with Ingo Swann's.
What are some of your impressions that you've had of Jupiter?
The first impression that came to me was a startling one, and of course we should mention that space module Pioneer 10, our space module, is en route to Jupiter now.
Yes. So we're going to see.
We'll bypass shortly. Jupiter December 3rd, so anyone listening in can check the impressions. We don't know how correct we are as yet.
And some will see this after them because we're taping ahead of time because of this special experiment and really be able to compare. What were the impressions you had of Jupiter?
The first contact my mind apparently made. And remember, there's no limitation in time or space to the extrasensory faculties. Once you get beyond the conscious realm and you're able to concentrate on subconscious levels, there's no limitation in time or space. I found myself beside the speeding space module Pioneer 10. I saw it was on a collision course with one of the great moons that surrounds Jupiter. And if the science, if NASA or whoever has charge, does not alter that course, is my conviction, it'll run into this moon and will never reach Jupiter,
well,
some million miles away.
Let's hope that doesn't, you know. Quite.
My mind then went beyond that, and I felt like a small speck in space, an infinitesimal speck in space. I wasn't conscious of the physical body as we now have a concept of it. I was a particle in space, and yet I could see in all directions. And as I approached this tremendous planet Jupiter, which is our largest planet, it seemed to have a bulge in the center, was a swirling mass of gigantic size, indescribable, with the brilliance which if I looked at it with my physical eyesight, I certainly must have been blinded by it. These are inner concepts, and it's very hard to convey to an audience, listening audience, unless they've had some unusual experiences.
To refer to as a point of reference.
To refer to as to how these sensations or impressions can come. Remember, I'm not claiming infallibility. But when the check report is made from Pioneer 10 after December 3rd, and it photographs and also with instrumentation gets its impressions. The many impressions that Inga Juan and I received, which are already identical, which amazes both of us.
You know, folks, in a sense, if we think about it, this is the first time, I think, in history that a professional scientific experiment is being revealed, some of the results ahead of time on television so that we can compare. Harold Sherman, I hope you will give us the pleasure of gracing our program again. We're going to have to go for a break, and thanks so much for coming here. Thank you so much. Well, the card spilled. That was remarkable. But if I can show you, we'll use here the Nine of Diamonds. What I'll do is insert it in the deck. Earlier when I did it, I used both hands. Now, I have to locate the position of that nine, which is 23 from the top. Watch. I've got it. We got it, folks, with one hand. When it's on the top. Now, folks, let's see the same thing. Same thing in slow motion. There it is. This is done this afternoon. The tape isn't altered. You see it being placed into the deck. I'm inserting it in. I don't even remember how far down. They did not show me this. I said, no, I don't want to see how it looks. But this is now in slow motion, and that's the actual movement, if you will. There's a break. Did you see that? You saw the break, which showed... Whoops, there we are. Now, I had to find the position of the card, and if I'm not mistaken, it did come to the top. Now, I think we do it one more time. This is not trick photography, and what I'm explaining... In doing this, they've even got my shuffling on slow motion, which is kind of wild. But what I'm explaining in doing this, I was talking to them, is that the first thing I do is get a good grip on the card. We're using, what's that, the King of Hearts. Fine. Now, I insert it in the deck. I tried to get it this time 26 from the top, and I missed by one card. It was 27 down, to be honest with you. It doesn't look as deep. Now, watch this, folks. At this moment, my one finger, the front finger, locates the position. That's a gambler's grip, which a card cheat would hold. I did it. I don't know if you saw a flash there, but folks, if you remember what the card was, and that picture card is on top again, there you are, my friends. Isn't that fascinating? Let me show you. Now, look. Do it one more time, if I may. We'll just take a card. We'll use the Two of Spades. Again, lest anyone wonder, I'll do this all with one hand through. There it is. I insert it into the deck. I don't even bring my other hand back because, folks... Oh, I missed. There you are. And that two is on top of it. Fascinating. Thank you, folks. Thank you. This has to be, for me, a nostalgic evening. This is the 26th show of this season, which is really the end of a third season. And to me, it's a very sensitive feeling. I feel very strong about what's happened in these three seasons. And I like to express it in music because this is a very sensitive song. I think it's going to be an all-time hit. It won an Academy Award, and when it won it, I didn't like it. But it's called The Morning After, and now I love it.
26 shows in the third season, and you know, in a little while, I'm going to ask my staff, which doesn't know this, to come forward and autograph this book, which will be the, these will be the first signatures I'll have for my collection of people who meant much to me in my life. I'm going to have my staff start to come in now because I really love them. They believed in me, and they're quite dedicated. I thank all of you for watching this whole season, the last three seasons. I hope you'll continue to look in, and I hope that as a mentalist, maybe in some small way, I brought to you a bit of mystery and a bit of entertainment through what I believe has been a unique approach to my art of the mind. So keep watching in. These are my staff. If they'll just enter their name in, keep watching. I'll join you soon. Very, very soon, folks. Be the good Lord willing. Take care for now. Folks, please. Don't misspell it.
In Ottawa, Kreskin and his guests stay at the beautiful Skyline Hotel. Skyline also have hotels in Toronto, Montreal, and Brockville, as well as Kingston, Jamaica, and London, England. Tilden Rent-A-Car offers top value on new Chevrolet and other GM cars with more than 300 locations across Canada. Tilden Rent-A-Car, we want to show you what a Canadian company can do.
We're riding it actually disappearing in Canada. Get your name. No, you go ahead. My makeup gal, yeah, the only way I can do it.